Okay, good morning everyone. So we're going to resume here with a quick study of the psychrometric chart. And this, the detail that's on here is really important for us to solve the problems we're looking at in this section. So I've got a small quiz for you to work on just to quickly check your skills. Feel free to take extras if people are not here and you want to pass one on to them. So this shouldn't take more than 4 or 5 minutes to recap yesterday's material. Just pass them down. Okay, so take a few minutes. Everyone got a quiz?
Thank you.
Anyone need a psychrometric chart? Some spares here. Take some extra for the exams, for studying. Oops, don't worry, I'll grab it. Okay. Okay, so a small hint, this page will be one page that's definitely in your exam booklet. You should be able to answer all the questions except maybe question 6 we haven't really covered just yet. Okay, so just finish up to number five. If you're finished, feel free to discuss your answers with the person next to you and see if you agree. Yeah. Oh yeah, lots of them. Take extras. So I've got lots of extra psychrometric charts. Feel free to grab extra so that you can study from them for the exams. Anyone need some more? Anyone else need some? Let's pass those down. Anyone need psychrometric charts up here? Good. Okay, so let's go through these answers quick. Question one, select all the statements which are true. First one, vapor pressure of moisture. True, false? True. The second one, partial pressure decreases when humidity decreases. True. Okay, let's just shout this out. For a pure water system, partial pressure equals the total pressure. True. Okay. Fourth one, for evaporation to occur, partial pressure must exceed vapor pressure. False. Yeah, it's the other way around. The system in equilibrium has vapor pressure equal to partial pressure. True. Okay. So that's the easy one. Just quick recall stuff from yesterday. Question two then says, check all options that apply. The psychrometric chart has a temperature axis. True. What specifically should we call that temperature? Wet bulb, dry bulb, dew point? This is the dry bulb temperature, okay? The other axis is humidity, mass on mass basis, so that's also correct. The third option, can you use this to find the boiling point of water? Yes, no? No, this one we definitely can't. Remember, this psychrometric chart is at one atmosphere, okay? And we know at one atmosphere boiling point of water is at 100. There's nothing here that would give us that sort of indication. We don't have it going far enough. Fourth option, will that appearance change at different pressures? Yes. Okay, so that's at one atmosphere. That chart will look a little different at higher pressures. The final option, can you use this to find the vapor pressure of water? No. You'd need to use the phase diagram that we looked at yesterday to find that. Okay, question three. Check all options that apply. The first one, air at 50 degrees has fully saturated at 87 grams of water per kilogram of dry air. True, okay. The second one, the dew point of saturated air at 50 degrees is also 50? True, yes. If the air is saturated, the dew point is the same as the dry bulb. Air at 50 degrees that's fully saturated in a closed system and then heated to 70 Celsius will then contain 30% humidity. True, okay, so 30% humidity would be for 70 degrees Celsius air. The next option, air at 50, that's closed and then heated to 70 will contain less water. False, okay. And then the final option, air at 50 Celsius that's saturated and then passed over an adsorbent to remove half the water then has 50% humidity. True, okay. If you follow that line, air at 50 degrees Celsius that's fully saturated and measure the humidity and then we're saying we're removing half of it and then you come down to that halfway point, you'll see that it does cross the 50% line, which is exactly what that line should be. Okay. The question four, the latent heat of vaporization at 25 Celsius is, any numbers? Anyone get this far down? No one did? Okay. Okay, latent heat of vaporization of water at 25 Celsius is interpolated between here. So it's 1/4 of the way down from 2,500 down to 2,400. So it's about 2,440. Okay, so it's a simple interpolation there. 2,440 would be your answer, and units of kilojoules per kilogram. Not kilojoules per kilogram Kelvin, right? This is heat of vaporization. This is the energy to go from liquid to vapor. So it's not a function of temperature. I mean, it's not, the units are not kilojoules per kilogram Kelvin. Okay, so it's not a heat capacity, it's a heat of vaporization. The fifth option asks you to use your psychrometric charts and find a mixture at 80 degrees Celsius, 1 atmosphere, and 10% humidity. So 80 degrees Celsius and 10% humidity, we're somewhere around here. Okay. No? Oh, that's 2%. Sorry, my mistake. 10%. We're somewhere over here. Okay, so if we read across, we're at about 0.055. Okay? And we're asking the humidity there at that point is, well, how many grams per kilogram of dry air? It's about, I may have misread it, it's about 56, 57 grams. Okay? Yeah, everyone's shaking their head. The dew point. 42, 43, 42.5, yes, no's. If you're not following along, make sure that you understand that the dew point is reading across. So once you're at this point, you read across and then back down again. I just want to emphasize that. We're going to look at this a little bit in a minute. The dew point, if you've got that curve, and here you've got your dry bulb temperature, you read whatever point you are, you read across and then down. Okay. We're going to add a third temperature to this system in a minute, the wet bulb temperature. So we have to understand what all three of these means. The dew point is simply taking that air and cooling it down, and what temperature do we first see the droplets forming? And then the final, the wet bulb temperature, we're going to look at that next. Okay, so you may not have got the third option, the wet bulb temperature. And question six, we're also going to look at next. So let's move on to that then. So that's a recap essentially of yesterday. And then moving on, we have to understand the wet bulb temperature. And to understand the wet bulb temperature, we have to consider this case of adiabatic saturation. Now, this is not difficult to understand. It's a seemingly hypothetical scenario where we're taking air and we're bringing air in at the side here at a temperature T and a humidity psi. Okay, so what I want you to do is think of it this way. We've got the system. Always going to be referring to the psychrometric chart. So here's T, and this axis is psi. So we're coming in at some point on this curve, right? We're somewhere on this two-dimensional world. Our inlet temperature T and our inlet humidity psi. And what we're doing is we're taking sort of like a shower head, right? So it's creating very fine droplets of water. And those water droplets, not all of them are going to stay in the liquid phase and land up here at the bottom. Some of that water will vaporize. So the humidity of the outlet gas then is higher, right? So that moisture has increased in the gas phase. What has happened to the temperature, TS? Other than it being obviously on the slide, but right, why is it decreasing? The temperature TS is decreased because the latent heat of vaporization required to take that water from liquid to vapor needs to come from somewhere. That energy, delta H, needs to come from somewhere, and it comes from this closed system. The system is sealed off, so the energy must come from within the system itself, and that means that the outlet gas leaves at a lower temperature. Okay, so plot the inlet temperature and the outlet temperature on this diagram. Where would those points be? Not the exact spots, but in general, what is T and psi and TS and psi S? Where are they located on that curve? So take a second and add that on there. So you need to have 2 points on that curve. Okay, everyone got two hypothetical points on there. So if you plotted it, you should have something like your T and psi here. This is your inlet. And we know that TS is going to be lower. So TS is going to be to the left of this. So we're going to be further down. And psi S is going to be greater than psi. So our humidity is going to be higher. We're going to be somewhere over there. So we could write that as TS and psi S. This is your outlet. Okay. So we're moving from that temperature to that temperature, and the lower humidity to the higher humidity. Well, we're going to see that that's a straight line. Okay, it's not guaranteed that it's a straight line, but in this case it is. Right? In practice, you could go from this inlet condition to that outlet condition in any number of ways, right? You could first raise the humidity at the same temperature and then drop over, or you could do it the other way around. But here we're going to follow this line, and it's called the adiabatic line for the following reason. We're going to do an energy balance over that system. An enthalpy balance, I should say. And the enthalpy balance is fairly straightforward. It says, what is the enthalpy coming into that system? Well, if we look at that system, we've got the gas coming in at a temperature T. And so when we do an enthalpy balance, we always have a reference temperature multiplied by CS. Wait, what's CS again? Let's go back to yesterday's class. CS was recorded over, did I pass over it? CS is the humid heat, the amount of energy to raise moist air by 1 degree Celsius. So the humid heat, kilojoules per kilogram Kelvin. So it's like a heat capacity, right? So CP delta T that you're used to, except in this case we use CS, the heat capacity of that inlet gas, temperature minus a reference, minus our base case. And that inlet air, we also account for the amount of moisture and the enthalpy, because it's an enthalpy balance, we take into account that it's in the vapor phase already. So there was some energy to get that inlet moisture in the vapor phase. Enthalpy leaving is CS again, the humid heat, but this time TS minus TS. We've chosen a reference point TS intentionally that way. Right, so T minus T ref, in this case I'm choosing T ref to be TS, so that I get this nice cancellation. And then again, the enthalpy for the moisture in the outlet gas. And that must balance, right? And when it balances, we can equate those two, and we get CS times T minus TS plus psi delta HVAP is equal to psi S. Okay. And rearranging that, bringing that term from the right-hand side over to the left, and then you'll get, basically, you'll get this happening. Sorry. You'll get a delta HVAP psi minus psi S term over there when you bring that term over. You can rearrange that equation to get what I've got finally down here. So psi minus psi S in your numerator divide through by T minus TS is equal to that term there on the right, minus CS over delta HVAP. Okay? And what that, let's take a look at what that says. Right? It says that change in humidity over change in temperature. Notice that change in humidity is your y-axis over change in temperature is your x-axis, is equal to this constant number. This constant is CS divided by delta HVAP. And there's a negative sign in there. So CS is a positive value, delta HVAP is a positive value. It says that the slope connecting psi and psi S and T and TS must have a negative slope. And that's that angle of that line. Okay, and those are, in fact, the lines that you see on your chart in front of you, the adiabatic saturation curves. Okay, so as this inlet air gets more and more moisture, its temperature drops, and it will follow that straight line and move over there. So when you want to answer this question of what is the wet bulb temperature, we follow that line. Okay, we follow that diagonal line over. Okay, and if you're not on one of those diagonal lines, we interpolate, and these lines are mostly parallel, so it's pretty easy to find the wet bulb temperature. Now, what is the wet bulb temperature? Let's just remind ourselves about that again. I had this exercise here for you, but I don't think we need to do it. It's very similar to the one that was in paper in front of you. So what I'll do is, if you've got your notes in front of you, I'll just give you a few minutes just to write those answers down. This is not something we need to spend some time repeating. It's very similar to the paper exercise. So just take those down for some practice at home. Okay, all this exercise looked at was moving along this line. The first question was basically looking at the humidity at this point. The next question, two, was looking at the humidity at the final point. Question three was asking you to read that humidity value off. And then question four was asking you to then just simply drop down here and find that temperature. And it's that temperature that I'm going to talk about next. Okay, so let me just emphasize what's going on here. Right, there's going to be these curves on the plot that do that. So we read the saturation temperature and we bump all the way into 100%. We're going to call this the wet bulb temperature. Remember, this was our dry bulb temperature. And earlier I had said that if you'd read horizontally, all the way till when you meet this line over here, that's the dew point. Okay, so we understand the dew point clearly. We understand the dry bulb clearly. Let's understand what wet bulb means now. Wet bulb is always going to be somewhere in between these two. Okay, and the wet bulb temperature, you'll recall, Oh, I hope at least if you learned about it in thermo or in 2D or 2F, that you learned about it in terms of how it's actually measured. So let's take a look here. Just going to turn the lights off a little bit. And the wet bulb temperature is essentially measured by taking two thermometers and putting them side by side. So we've got regular thermometers there, but the one thermometer, the top one, is covered in a cotton wick. And we wet that cotton. So what we're measuring essentially is the temperature inside that cotton wick that's wet. This second thermometer below is your regular dry bulb temperature. So we're going to measure these two side by side. And what we do is we take this device, and it's on a hinge over here that rotates, and we're just going to swing it around, okay, in the air. And the water that's in that cotton is going to start evaporating. And how much of it will evaporate is totally dependent on the ambient dry bulb temperature, as well as the humidity that's already in the air. If the air is very humid, not very much is going to evaporate. If the air is very dry, a lot will. Conversely, if it's a cold day versus a hot day ambiently, remember that's what the second thermometer is measuring, the ambient regular temperature. So the amount of evaporation from that wick, from that moist wick, will be totally dependent on the ambient humidity and the ambient dry bulb temperature. So the wet bulb temperature is very much a function of humidity. Okay, so where you land up over here is a function of humidity. I'll demonstrate that to you in a minute. And also, it's a function of where you started off, what your dry bulb temperature is. Okay, so we're going to measure the wet bulb temperature, and it will always be lower than the dry bulb. Okay, do the following. Lick your skin and blow on it. That temperature that you're experiencing on your skin, that's the wet bulb temperature. Okay, that's the temperature that a solid that you're drying is experiencing. It's that temperature right at that interface. Okay, and you notice that it's a colder temperature. It feels cold when you do that. Okay, so it's a lower temperature than the ambient temperature right now. Okay, so wet bulb temperature then is that number that we land up to. Now, there's a little bit of complexity here. The adiabatic saturation line that I derived with an enthalpy balance, okay, and the wet bulb temperature are actually derived by two very different ways, but it's a nice coincidence that they follow exactly the same line with the same slope. But the mechanism actually behind it is a little bit different. But it's a good coincidence and one that we exploit. So the wet bulb temperature is simply follow your adiabatic saturation line all the way to 100% and then drop down. And that's the value you read as your wet bulb temperature. Now, I did want to emphasize this important point. I said to you that the wet bulb temperature will depend on the humidity, right? You'll get a different wet bulb temperature if the humidity is a different value. Let me prove that to you very simply by plotting two psychrometric charts below each other. Okay, so there's your dry bulb temperature in each case, and here's your humidity in each of the cases. And I'm just going to draw a 100% line. I'm going to try and make them look the same. Okay, so these are basically two copies of the same plot, two lines. Now, what we can do is, let me just bump this up so it looks the same. Okay, I'm trying to demonstrate to you that the ambient humidity is very much going to affect the wet bulb temperature. So let's take the first case where we've got very low humidity. Okay, so this is low humidity. So low RH, we're far away from that saturation line. And I'm going to use the same dry bulb temperature. Okay, but then this time I'm going to show a case of high humidity. Now, if you're drawing this in front of you, let me give you a minute to try and do this, prove it to yourself. Find the wet bulb temperature for both cases. Before I show you, just try it yourself. Find the wet bulb temperatures for both instances. Okay, if that's presenting some difficulty to you, the easier one to find for both cases is the dew point temperature. Find the dew point temperature for both cases. Okay, so let me start with the dew point temperature. The dew point temperature, remember, is just reading across and down. So there's the dew point temperature for the first case. For the second case, the dew point temperature, you read across. So I'm going to call that T dew point 2 and T dew point 1. Okay, so notice at high humidity, your dew point temperature is closer to your dry bulb temperature. Let's look at the wet bulb temperature. That was the one that I asked you to start with. Now, we're going to use the fact that those diagonal lines are parallel to each other, right? So whatever the angle is, and let's say the angle might be this, these angles are going to be the same on both curves. Okay, so if I follow that angle for this low humidity case, and then come back down here, there's my wet bulb temperature for the first case. And for the second case, we go at that same angle. And we come back down. Yeah.
What's the angle?
That's that diagonal line of the that we see on this chart. Yeah. Okay, so notice then that at low humidity, these three temperatures are spaced far apart. At high humidity, these three temperatures are closer together. You can obviously appreciate from this construction that at 100% humidity, all three temperatures are the same. Okay? Now, why did I spend 5-10 minutes emphasizing this to you? Well, let's understand this. When you're drying something, so I asked you to lick your hand and blow on it, right? That's the temperature that you're experiencing on the surface. The surface that you're drying is going to experience that temperature, the wet bulb temperature. So this is the surface temperature. Okay. The surface of the solid. Okay, so this is going to be the surface of the solid. Is always going to be at the wet bulb temperature. If you're drying, let's say, pet food, or you're drying a pharmaceutical tablet, or you're drying wood, the temperature that the solid is experiencing is that wet bulb temperature. Okay? The temperature that you're supplying to do the drying, so you're blowing hot air, or you're just putting the wood outside, or whatever the heating source is that you're providing, that's going to be your dry bulb temperature. Okay, so that's this temperature over here. Okay, if you're going to put this pet food in a kiln to dry it, I'll show you some examples of equipment in a minute, or you're going to just put the wood in a heated room, that room temperature that you measure is the dry bulb temperature. Why am I emphasizing this? Well, I'm emphasizing it because this distance this difference. That's your driving force, right? If the solid is at this temperature and the air is at that temperature, that difference is your driving force. That's the amount of energy available to drive the evaporation at low humidity. At high humidity, you can see what's happening here. At high humidity, that difference now is incredibly small. Okay. And remember, we come to this over and over in this course, that the flux is equal to the driving force over the resistance. Okay, so if we want to evaporate material away, you want to move moisture away from your solid, you want the flux of that water to be great, the only way to do so is to provide a greater driving force. So practically, this means that we should use what sort of conditions? If you want to maximize the speed at which you're drying something, what sort of conditions do you need? At least two. Daniel? Low humidity is the first one. Anything else that you can do to increase that driving force? Increase the temperature of the heat source. So move over to the left from your heat source. So that's going to be an operating cost. And use air that's at low humidity. So whatever your air intake is, ensure that it's at low humidity. Okay, let me test your knowledge. How many of you have, you've gone out a long night of being out and about, you get into the car on a cold winter's night, four or five of you, and the windscreen fogs up? Okay, you've all experienced that. You want to evaporate that water off the glass the fastest. What do you do? There's two or three things that you can do. So discuss it maybe for a minute with someone next to you. What do you do to get that water off the glass the fastest? Okay, let's hear some suggestions. You want to get that water off the fastest so you can drive safely home. What can you do? Helen? Turn on the AC. What's that going to do? You're on the right track. Okay, let's just hear some other thoughts. We'll come back to that one. Yeah?
Open the windows.
Open the windows. Why? So it can decrease the humidity and decrease the temperature. Okay, remember we want the temperature to be higher. All right, Sean?
I would say you turn the heat on because that increases your temperature, the heat, sort of the air in the car, which is the higher driving force to get rid of the humidity.
Okay, so you want to turn the heat on in the car or on that air source to get that dry bulb temperature higher. Okay, so definitely want hot air. Anything else? You're on the right track there, Helen. And AC on or off? Let's on or off for AC. Joseph?
The problem when you get in your car is not it's that your air is too hot once you enter because you're breathing and that's what happens. The water that's in the air condenses on the window on the inside.
Yeah.
So you can either heat it so that water becomes vapor again.
Yeah.
Or you can just open your windows so that it reaches equilibrium and all the water comes out.
Okay, so open your windows. It's definitely a batch process, right? There's a transient. It's not a steady state system. So there's that complicating factor. Other suggestions?
Doesn't the air work not be the lowest temperature, but air conditioning lowers temperature by removing water?
Okay.
Air
conditioning works based on the principle of removing moisture from the air. So that's where Helen was going with that. So by turning on the AC, you're actually lowering the humidity in the car. By cranking the heat up, you've now got a hot, dry air stream. So you can turn on the AC and still have heat. Most cars allow that. So AC will pull the humidity out the interior of the car. But the air that you want to blow on that dial that you switch to blow the air onto the dash is going to be a hot stream. Okay, so a hot stream with low humidity in the car. Open and close the windows.
I would say if you're doing all that, keep them closed.
If you're doing all of that, keep them closed. Okay. Think of this, there's flux is driving force over resistance. What's driving the moisture from liquid into vapor is that temperature difference. Right? But if you want to keep that going, keep that moisture coming off the glass, you have to get rid of the moisture that's in the air in some way. Okay, eventually the moisture in the car is going to build up, so you want to get rid of it, and one way is to keep the AC on. It might also be to your advantage, if the AC can't keep up with it, to also open the windows, at least temporarily, and get some fresh, drier air back into the car again, okay, if the AC can't keep up with it. So it's not a clear-cut answer, right? Because it will depend on the capability of your AC to do that.
So, going off Joseph's point, does it fog up because bodies are warm or because bodies give off water?
No, it fogs up because of your breath. You're exhaling moisture, and it's on a cold glass surface. Okay, so you're walking into a car that's at ambient temperature, say -5. All this moisture at -5. Let's take a look. What's the?
Is it the same as seeing your breath when it's cold outside? Outside?
You're seeing your breath when it's cold outside, right? So if you look at this curve, what happens when you get to low temperatures? See how very quickly you'll saturate. See how very quickly you'll reach dew point. Right? You'll bump into that dew point almost instantaneously. Okay, so that's why a car fogs up so rapidly when you get inside it. Okay, who knew chemical engineering was so practical? So we've got this idea. And then lastly, the idea of resistance. You can minimize resistance as well in the car by turning on the velocity of that dial. So turn it all the way up to the maximum speed. And that will reduce the resistance. Why do I say that? Well, if you consider the glass surface here, okay, and then there's this layer of moisture on it. Okay, if you can impact this with a high velocity or a low velocity stream, you'd rather use a high velocity stream because it minimizes this liquid has to go into vapor, and this vapor will sit here at the surface and create a boundary. So using high velocities gets rid of that boundary layer and ensures that you can get mass transfer at a faster rate. Okay. So we'll see this in practical equipment. I'll probably only get a chance to do this in next class. Yeah, so let's... this is again one of these simple problems. I'd rather go through equipment design in the next class and do that all in one go. To end off with, then here's another example I had in the slides. Again, it's fairly straightforward. Feel free to copy those numbers down. It was asking you if you took air at 55 degrees Celsius with a given humidity, what would be the dry bulb temperature, the dew point temperature, the humid heat. Let me just come to the humid volume for a minute, okay? So I'll come back to the slide for you to copy the numbers down. There's one other concept I do need to cover before tomorrow's class, Friday's class, and that's humid volume. Humid volume is very easy to understand, okay? Humid volume is the inverse of the density. So take moist air. Moist air has a particular density, kilograms per meter cubed. Okay. For whatever reason, the literature in this topic uses the inverse of it, and they give it a new name called humid volume. So that's all it is. There's nothing conceptually hard to understand, and you'll notice that the units are, as well, kilograms of moist air per meter cubed. Okay, so how do we derive humid volume? Well, it's a simple ideal gas law balance. You want to calculate the density of an air mixture plus a water mixture, and you just add the two up and weight it up. Now, we know that air and water's temperature, sorry, their density varies with temperature. So that's what we have that temperature factor accounting for out there. And here's an example calculation for you to try out at home. Make sure you can do this. Air at 350 with that humidity of 0.026 kilograms per kilogram, that you get a number close to 1. Remember, the density of dry air is a number around 1. 1 kilogram per meter cubed. So if we're inverting that, we should get a number close to 1 again. 1 kilogram of moist air per meter cubed. And what you'll find is that you can go plug in a variety of humidity values here at a variety of temperatures. This number is pretty much, it's always around 0.95 to 1.05. Okay, so if you're stuck or you want to just cross-check your calculation to make sure that you've got a good, reasonable answer, this number should be close to 1. Okay, so humid volume is simply inverse density. So we've got all our concepts ready to go on Friday to do some good case studies and learn about the equipment. As I said, I'll just put that slide up for you to copy those numbers down if you want to practice at home. Just one other thing before we end off the class. I've posted all the final exams that I've used in this course on the course website for you to start practicing on. In fact, you'll notice that all those questions you've probably seen in various assignments, so they're not entirely unfamiliar to you.